Okay, it's 3:30. I think we can start now. So, hello everybody. My name is Joachim Unger. Daniel already introduced me. So, together with him, we are working for EOX, a small company, or not so small anymore, from Austria, Vienna. We mainly do projects with ESA in the area of satellite imagery, so processing, writing clients, and today I will be talking about Mapchete. It's a tool developed by us, and it does tile-based geodata processing. And let's see whether it can break the curse of Rastersite server processing. So the project is available on GitHub, so it's a Python package. You have here the URLs to the GitHub repository, as well as some documentation on Read the Docs. It's been published under a MIT license, and at least our test suite tested against Python versions 3.5 to 3.7. We first created it 4 years ago, and it has been in development since, serving us for our various projects, so like creating web maps and doing some satellite imagery and processing. So the initial idea was to use Python code because Python is a very nice language to learn, so it's not as complex as other ones, so that's why Python is so popular. To use this and build a framework around it to facilitate global scale processing. And the core idea is simply that you write your Python function, and then Mapchete takes it and reads the data and applies this function on your data, and then writes an output. That's basically it. So here I wrote or we created a short diagram that should explain it a little bit better. So as in every type of processing, you have inputs, so data inputs and data outputs, and there's something happening in between. So what's happening in between is, as I mentioned before, the Python process. It could also be Cython if you wrap it under using Python. The nice thing is you have access to NumPy or SciPy or any image processing libraries like Pillow, Scikit, and whatnot. And as inputs, we are heavily using Rasterio and Fiona to read raster and vector inputs. So Mapchete takes, for example, a raster image and then converts it into an NumPy array, which then is available within the process function. Likewise, with vector data, we use Fiona to open it and basically use the GeoJSON-like dictionary and pass it on to the process function. It's also modular, which means you can write plugins. So internally, we created a satellite archive reader, which basically reads the Sentinel-2 archives and Sentinel-1 archives from AWS and Mundi and converts it into a four-dimensional array, which then we will have available within our process function again. And as output, likewise, we use Rasterio and Fiona to store either single geotiffs or so-called tile directories. I will go into a little bit more detail afterwards, or write in GeoJSONs if you have a vector output. And there are also plugins available and can be extended by plugins. So, for example, we also have an X-Array writer, which allows to write a tile directory where the tiles are not geotiffs, but X-Array dumps. So, for example, netcdf or SAR files. So what you need to create a process is have a so-called Mapchete file. It's basically a YAML, so it follows the YAML syntax. And here you define simply your inputs, your output, so where it should be stored, which driver to use, which compression, whatever. You define your pyramid or grid, because as I told you before, we are processing in tiles, so every input data has to be brought to the same grid or to the same pyramid. So you have to define it here, and of course you can also add some custom parameters for your process function. the process function is being stored in a Python file, so we just need a process or a Python file containing an execute function. And this execute function can open the data and do whatever you want with it, and then you return either a NumPy array if you write the raster output or a GeoJSON-like feature list for vector output. The tile directory output is something we borrowed a concept from WMTS. Ivan was mentioning the web maps. So web maps are split up, as you know, in tiles and process levels. And so when you access, for example, OpenStreetMap, your browser would query PNGs or JPEGs according to a certain tile directory structure. So the first number you see here is the zoom level. The second you see here is the column, and then there's the row. And we simply use geotiffs or X-array dumps or whatever to store the data. It has some big advantages. So for example, multiple processes can write into the same output because it's not a single file. It's based on many files, so you can do a great parallel processing, and you can store really, really large data. So we are processing Sentinel-2 cloudless mosaics. So we have a worldwide 10-meter coverage, and we store it in this format. So it's not a one big TIFF, but it's thousands of TIFFs. And as soon as we know, and if we know the structure and the tiling scheme, we can easily query the tiles we need for a given bounding box. So you could say it's a little bit like a cog, but split up into multiple files because we have internal tiling and overviews, but it might be an exaggeration as well. And yeah, as I mentioned before, we are not bound to geotiffs. We can also do, of course, PNGs as already possible, and GeoJSONs, NetCDFs, whatever. And natively, MapJetta can also read and write from and to S3 buckets, which also helps with the cloud processing use case. So you could have various workers, and they all write into the same bucket. So that's very handy. It's being run via the command line. So the command line interface has a couple of commands. I will quickly pass through it. There's a command called formats, which simply lists the already installed formats. I mentioned the plugins before. Here you can see whether your plugin already installed or not. Likewise, with processes, we can also register processes. So you don't have to provide the path to a Python file, but you can also point it to a Python module path. And if you register it into the main package, then it gets listed here. The create command simply creates a new MapJetta and dummy Python file, so it's been there to make it easier to create a new process. There's a surf command. So the surf command is very interesting for debugging. It runs or it starts a Flask server on your local host. So, and then you can open the browser and an OpenLayers map would show up. And as you zoom and pan through the map, it would actually process the tiles and show you your current process outputs. So it's quite handy when you're developing your process or playing around with scripts and parameters that you immediately see the results. Then there's the main command is the execute command. It simply executes the whole process on your given AOI. Because GDAL cannot read tile directories, of course, there's an index command, and index would simply create either a VRT file, or if you later on use it with map server, you can also create a shape index file. Because map server is, because the VRT is not really optimized for a large mosaic of data containing thousands and millions of files. So map server has this special format. It's a shape file or can be a geo package where just the bounding boxes of your tiles are stored, and then it can easily read it. And with this index command, you can create it in one line of command. And there's a convert command. It heavily borrows from the syntax of Rio convert, so the Rasterio command line tool. It simply extends it by being able to read and convert to tile directories and vice versa. So you can use it if you have a global data set. So for example, when we get a customer request, they want a certain country or AI from our global mosaic, we use this command to extract a subset. I'm now going to show you some examples. So the first, it's barely legible. Okay. So the first example I wanted to show you is the Hillshade. So it's mainly, or I think you could say it's the Hello World or NDVI example of cartography. So Ivan already mentioned it. Unfortunately, it's very dark. So on the left side, you see the YAML configuration, and you see that you can just provide the path to the Python file. Then the next block should be the pyramid. So here we have one of our standard pyramids. It's called the geodetic pyramid. You can set performance settings like meta tiling, so it would not process the 256 times 256 tiles, but 2x2 of these tiles, which makes much of the processes a lot faster. Then you have an input section, and input can be anything. So it can be a path to a TIFF, either remote or local, or some special input from one of your plugins. And at the output, likewise, you just specify which of the output formats you want to have and which bands, and there are some driver-specific settings. Then you have optional parameters, so you can limit the zoom levels you want to process, because we are always talking about tile pyramids. And the last section is the process parameters. So in this case, you have the Hillshade parameters, so like the azimuth, the altitude, and the exaggeration factor, the set factor. And what you probably don't see here, we can have zoom level dependent parameters. So what I did here below is to have the exaggeration factor of the elevation model being, it changes between the zoom levels. So the more you zoomed out, the more exaggeration we want to have, because we want to have the mountains shine out. And on the right side, you have the execute function. It's quite straightforward. So you have this magic MP object, which opens data. Then you have the Hillshade function, which just takes this NumPy array. And then you return the NumPy array, and you're done. So my initial idea was to do a live demo, but it didn't really work out. So here you have a browser window. So, and on the top, you see the command I would have to run. It's the mapchat to serve and then the path to the file. And then in the background, it would process the tiles that you're looking at. So whether you pan or zoom in or zoom out. The second example is the first example, but with filters. So it also calculates the Hillshade, but you can also import Pillow and SciPy and do some Gauss filters, median filters to play around to generalize the elevation model a little bit, so to optimize for your visualization for your Hillshade output. It's really bad that you cannot see it. So I will have to explain. So it's just has more lines. So what it does is to convert the NumPy array to the format that Pillow requires, and then applies this filter, and then you go to the next step. So you see, as more complex as your use case will be, your Python process file would grow with it, but you can do a lot of stuff here. So this would be the output of the filtered mosaic. I have the time series. Oh, what I forgot to mention is you can also do clipping. So the reason you won't see any bathymetry here is because we also provided a shapefile and told the process file to clip the raster via the geometries. So we were using this a couple of years ago already to create the hill shadings of our WMS maps. And it was quite fun and quite handy to work with it. What we also did was to extract contour lines out of elevation models. I will skip through this a little bit faster. What we did in our maps was we wanted to show the contour lines in different colors depending on the underground they're in. So for example, on water, there should have been blue. On land, brown, and we wanted to have blue or light blue contour lines on glaciers. So what this process does is simply reads a dem, extract the contour lines, intersect it with a different geometry. So in this example, it's simply the natural earth lens polygon, and returns the GeoJSON output, which then we could, so this is a screenshot from QGIS, so I visualized the contour lines depending on whether they are over land or over sea. So you can, you can do different visualizations here. This is a more recent example because we are doing a lot of mosaics, so we are trying out different approaches, and here we tried out some image segmentation. So we are using one of our existing mosaics. One of the reasons I'm showing you the example is if you see on the top left corner, you see a path to an S3 bucket, but it's not a TIFF, it's just a directory. It's because it's a tile directory, so you can out of the box just point it to this input and it would recognize it and the tiling scheme and then read the data accordingly. So this would have been very cool to show live, but we have to do it via screenshots here. So what we did with this example was to take the RGB mosaic and use a scikit learn or a scikit function that does image segmentation and use the output segments and visualize it in a nice way. So just draw the red outlines over the, Is it visible? Okay, a little bit. So, and here again, the nice thing was you can zoom and pan, and in the background, it would load the GeoTIFFs and extract the NumPy arrays, run the segmentation, and then renders the PNGs, which then can be visualized in the browser. And here I have a zoomed in version of Bucharest. So, and this makes it really nice to fiddle around with the process parameters and how many segments to use and how big should they be and does it even work or is the output the way I want it to be and yeah, stuff like that. So to wrapping it up, we switched to a plugin based system. So we try to keep the core package as small as possible, but using plugins to extend it via processes or input or output formats. Therefore, we use the Python setup tools entry points, which is quite easy to use. And there's also it's also on GitHub, it's our Xarray driver, so you can try it out there. Simply put pip install Mapcheta and Mapcheta Xarray, and you can read and write multidimensional data as well. There was already a PostGIS plugin, but it's been written like 4 years ago, and I didn't manage to keep it updated since then. But it could be extended via this way as well. So you see, we can be very flexible towards different types of data and data structures. Because Ivan mentioned GeoTIFF.js, more than 1 year ago, I supervised the master thesis that would, where the topic was, can we read those tile directory TIFFs in open layers? And how would it work? And then under which circumstances would it be efficient or not? So, I mean, it was already discussed, but for the use case that the user just wants to have one single visualization, it's probably better to have it processed on the server or rendered on the server and just visualized on the client. But if the user wants to interact with the data, then it's better. But then you have to weigh the pros and cons, because if you transfer the data, it takes time. So it depends really on the download speed. And if you want to interact a lot with the data, then you pay the price. If you don't want to, then the service simply gets slower. What we are now working on is to make GeoTIFF.js able to read tile directories, because GeoTIFF.js now can just read single TIFFs. But the idea is to point GeoTIFF.js to a tile directory, and it reads the tile structure. And while rendering the data, or while being provided with a bounding box, it should figure out which TIFF to read and which subsets and how to warp it to put it into the correct output. But there we have to, we still have a big chunk of conceptual work in front of us, because the current tile pyramid definition is very minimal. Let's put it this way. It worked for our use cases the past years, but to make it interoperable with other tools, we might have to change here and there something of the concepts. Yeah, and the target of this would be to have, so the open layers interface I showed you, it just works with PNGs. So the target would be to have GeoTIFFJS there so that your process output could be any type of TIFF, and you could interact with and query it while your GeoTIFF tiles get rendered or get processed by the server, and then you can directly look into the data. Because the other possibility would just have to be that you create a bunch of TIFFs, run the VRT index command, and then open it in QGIS. And having it directly in the browser would be much more nicer and efficient. So next step and some follow-up talks I recommend. So the next step would be to work on the GeoTIFFJS client. Before that, we have to figure out the tile directory spec. So if you think this data structure will be useful or would be useful for any of your use cases, then feel free to contact either me or Fabian. We'll be happy to get some help there, because more brains working on the same problem is usually better than having just two. And what's also on my agenda is to write to implement the possibility to write single geotiffs with custom overviews, meaning that the overviews in a geotiff not being generated from the base level, but you can write each overview individually with different settings. So this, for the hillshade example, this would really be nice, because then you could store the hillshade in one tiff, and depending on the zoom level, it's a little bit different. At least for this use case, it would be great. Yeah, the follow-up talks. Fabian is the creator of GeoTIFFJS. He will talk tomorrow afternoon. So I really, if you found these talks in this session interesting, you should go there. And also tomorrow in the same session, there's my colleague Peter going a little bit more into detail on our cloudless processing. And yeah, it's also, I think, in the same session tomorrow afternoon in the Oprah room. So thank you for your attention. And yeah, feel free to get in contact if you have any questions or suggestions.
All right, so I think we managed to catch up a little bit, the little delay in the display at the beginning. So we're in time. We don't need this 5 minutes of changing rooms now. And so you have 5 minutes for questions. So yeah, I think for everyone that has been working with different sources and bringing things together and larger data sets, this can have or has some potential, or you see some potential in this tool, so maybe give it a look. And so if you have some questions for Joachim, yeah, sure.
Yeah, so the tile director, you say you are going to work on the specification, but right now is it like a similar approach, like when you do the GDI to tile, you store the data by zoom and then by tile?
Yeah, currently, yes. We follow the WMTS simple approach, which just defines the web Mercator and the geodetic tiling scheme. And yeah, we added on top, you know, the possibility to store the tiles in meta tiles and even using the paddings, the pixel buffers. But we just wanted to define it a little bit more explicit. So there's a Python package in the core of Marchetta called Tile Matrix. And the possible tile pyramid definitions there are very, very basic, so not at all the whole scope that WMTS, for example, provides. But you can do whatever projection you want as well. It's just not that obvious to use a non-default tiling scheme, and we want to improve on that.
All right, so any more questions? It's really all right. Yeah. So.
I wonder if you can give us some performance data. For example, how long it takes to generate this shape.
Well, it takes just a couple of seconds. Okay, sorry. The question was whether I could provide some performance information on, for example, how long the hillshade would take. Yeah, it's just a couple of seconds. Yeah.
For the
quick view. I mean, it strongly depends on what the underlying geotiff is. So I usually create the geotiffs with overviews. Because otherwise, if there are no overviews and you try to do zoom level 3, it will take a while. But then, it's super fast. I mean, for the heavy lifting, we are using Rasterio, which has GDAL on the bottom, which uses C. So the warping is fast. Then we have access to NumPy arrays. So if the algorithms are fast, thing works. Yeah. But as I mentioned, the tiling scheme or the meta tile setting also plays a big role. So usually it's better to have bigger tiles so than to have many, many smaller ones.
Yep.
So the question was if there is a big TIFF, whether there should be some pre-processing in order to be used with this library. Short answer, no. So everything that can be read with Rasterio should work with Mapjeta as well. Long answer, yes. You might get some more performance if you use internal tiling and overviews. So the question is whether we use multiprocessing to process multiple tiles. Yeah, we use either the multiprocessing package or we can alternatively use Billiard, which is the multiprocessing fork used by Celery, so that we can have a Celery worker use a spawn multiple process as well. So the question is whether it's possible to distribute it on multiple workers. Well, we have a wrapper around it, but it's not yet open sourced, which we might do in the next months. Maybe not. I don't know. But basically, yeah. So you have your Mapjeta workers, and you send them a process, and they will do it the same. We don't do really we don't distribute the tile processes themselves, because on the large scale processing we found out that it's better to cache some of the data, and therefore it makes more sense to have one zone with multiple tiles being processed by one worker that has cached data. But yeah, there's something in the pipeline here.
All right, so I think one last question. Depending on your necessity for coffee. All right, so great. I think thank you very much all for your time. Thank you for all the great presentations. I see some of you in a little bit after the coffee break. So thank you all.